anyone knows those answers, it's our Lord.
Yes. I trust in our Lord to provide them.
I know it feels strange to say it at first. It makes us all sound like religious loons. Except our Lord is real. You haven't had anyone protecting you since the flood took your family away. Now you do. This has been my family since I was a little girl.
It's an honor to be part of the family.
I know someone who'll be very happy to hear that.
Our founder is coming.
Hello and welcome to episode 4 of the Three Body Podcast. We are your hosts, Jason Concepcion and Dr. Maggie Aderin-Pocock. And this is the official companion podcast for Three Body Problem on Netflix. On today's episode, it's all about the mysterious ETO, the quasi-terrorist organization who have been busy murdering members of the scientific community and sabotaging experiments all around the world, and whose actions have changed the fate of humanity. They would say, I think, for the better, but I think we would clearly think for the worse. Right, Maggie?
Yes, yes. I really don't trust the Earth Tri-Solaris organization. They are definitely shady, and I don't think they have our best interests at heart.
Oh, I don't think they do.
In this episode, we'll be hearing from Three Body Problems director, Minkie Spiro, about the plot so far, on working with the incredible Three Body Problem cast, and we'll be learning about the mechanics behind creating the amazing and yet visually brutal Panama Canal scene.
Yes, and with the help of our expert guest, Dr. Alexandra Stein, who specializes in cults and extremist groups, will be diving into the psychology behind the ETO, discovering how similar fanatic extremist organizations successfully recruit regular people, and how the ETO might justify the extreme and often deadly actions that its members carry out in the name of their Lord.
Yes, I mean, we are jam-packed with this episode. We're covering so much. But of course, before we go any further, it's time to give the usual spoiler alert. We will be covering content from episodes 4 and 5 of The Three Body Problem. So if you haven't watched that yet, we suggest you pause this podcast now, go and catch up with these 2 episodes on Netflix, and then come on back to us and we'll be here to dissect with you.
Now, Maggie, I have been thinking a lot about the ETO, and it feels very natural to me that a group might try to bring about the invasion of Earth from within. But what do you think their motivations are? Why do you think they're doing this?
The thing is, they have more evidence that there's something there. But the religious connotation of our Lord, you know, this is our Lord, makes me feel uncomfortable. There was a wonderful piece. I can't remember who said it, but, you know, did humans create God or did God create humans?
Yeah.
And it's almost as if we need this other. And I think humans respond to that other, that thing out there. And they have this tangible thing out there. So maybe it sort of draws people in.
Back in Mongolia, we see Dr. Ye back in the 60s. She is given a copy of the book Silent Spring, which is a landmark environmental treatise. Are you familiar with the book? I wonder if you could explain the importance of this book to the audience.
The book is very important. So it is a real book, and it was written by an American marine biologist and conservationist, Rachel Carson. It was published back in 1962, which I think is quite interesting because I always put it down to sort of images we got from space. But I think this is when the environmental movement really started to blossom. And it's an early warning for humankind's impact on nature and the environment. And it reflects on many of the things that we are sort of contemplating today. But it was sort of trying to create sort of public awareness and change the way we treat our planet, get governments to change their policies. And it's still, you know, with the whole sort of climate change thing going on, it's something that's an ongoing battle. But I think she was well ahead of the game.
Yeah, and that's seeing that book on Mike Evans's shelf years later, I think, is the thing that sparks the connection. And it's so fascinating to think about how this small moment between two people is changing the course of history, isn't it?
Yes. Gosh, I mean, it puts a lot of responsibility on this book.
Yeah.
This book could have caused the demise of humanity. I'm not blaming Rachel. It wasn't her fault.
You know, it's something I think. I'm an amateur history buff. I read a lot of history, and it is one thing that always stands out to me is how, in the course of these titanic events, often an underrated factor in the movement of history is just the animosity or the affinity between two people. Two people didn't like each other, and therefore a war sparks off. Or two people just hit it off, and therefore an alliance is formed. And it just is interesting that these two people share this connection based on, honestly, very little actual factual information. It's just like, I'm unhappy with the way things are going in the world. You're also unhappy with the way things are going in the world. We connect on that. Therefore, let's invite the aliens and have them invade.
Yeah, you've been watching them, but let's just seal the deal.
Yeah, yeah.
But, and the thing is, they come from such different backgrounds.
It's so true.
He's sort of a son of a billionaire. She has her father who was not killed in front of her. And yet these two words collide. But it makes me feel quite vulnerable, or us quite vulnerable, because our destiny is dependent on these connections that can happen. And we have no idea where they can lead.
Well, so much of what's driving Mike and Ye is this lack of agency, right? They can't do anything about the things that they see, that the problems that they face. Dr. Ye, of course, was a prisoner, essentially, for many years. And so once they are given this opportunity to take the steering wheel, they must leap at it. They must do it. And for the rest of us, we're just, you know, the rest of the people who are watching this, the scientists around the world who are getting murdered, they similarly have their agency taken away. And it all culminates in this really shocking attack that Thomas Wade unfurls the Panama Canal on the Judgment Day boat. It is one of the most visually stunning things I think I've ever seen. And you kind of get, it's at that moment where I realize, okay, maybe the aliens are right about Augie's nanofibers. Maybe those things are too dangerous. Have you ever seen anything like this?
So people sort of talk about graphene and sort of making fibers out of that. And sort of, yeah, but I think that is the challenge with science. It can be used for amazing things. It can be used for devastating things. And so the problem isn't within the science itself, but how people employ that science. And we can see Augie's angst.
Yeah, it is obviously heartrending for Augie to watch her creation be used to kill several thousand people. We're unsure of how many people are on the boat, but very interesting to think about why just be on a boat. Why opt out of society completely? You'd think that they'd have more leverage considering their mission by continuing to integrate with society, not to take themselves out of it, to be on this boat that just floats around. And I guess, you know, gives them the ability to have these, Mike at least, to have these numerous therapy sessions with the Sophon. But what do you think the upside would be to just living on this boat?
To me, international waters. So yes, what happens out there is... Also, I think because you're always on the move, you're harder to track. And so I think that's a benefit. And also, I think they want to interact with society, but only the powerful in society. I don't know, scientists, engineers, the people who will make a difference. And so
that's a good point.
They're still trying to recruit those people. But I think that the hoi polloi, it's almost as if they've abdicated them. They're the pawns. They're disposable.
Yeah.
But yes, we need to get these key people on board. And so that's what we will interact with. And we will draw them into our small and elite group. But everybody else, we just don't really care about.
The conversations between Mike and the Santi are so fascinating. It's quite interesting, don't you think, to see how little they actually do know about humanity and even how little they understand about perspective. Everything they are learning is through the lens of one of the richest men in the world.
Yes.
Is that the way to do it? You know, it's quite interesting, isn't it?
It is. I don't think Mr. Evans represents society.
I don't think so.
Part of the elite. But also, yes. And how far can you get with conversation? And I think there are assumptions. Sorry, too many thoughts at once. I think there are assumptions going on because the Santi sort of live more as a hive mentality where everybody interacts, that sort of common thoughts. it's just a very, very different perspective. And these one-to-one conversations, I think, are quite dangerous. And the fact that one person can decide the fate of humanity.
Just one,
absolutely,
yes.
Terrifying. And yet then another person is giving the santee an understanding of society. But of course, that is just so biased and so personal that it isn't a good representation at all.
Yeah.
It's a diversity problem, really.
I completely agree. Now, Mike quite shockingly learns that the santee do not lie. They are incapable of deceiving each other. This is why you say, and I quite agree, that they are probably some sort of hive mind where they, like an octopus or like certain aquatic animals or some, or fungus or something like that. They just share information across the network, and that's how they communicate with each other. Quite a shocking moment for Mike, and quite an advantage for us, wouldn't you say, for Thomas Wade and the forces of Earth Defense?
Yes. I was contemplating this because it means what the Santee tell us is their intentions. There's no deceit, there's no guise. Anything they tell us, we can take as read. And that is quite powerful because in most situations or in war situations, you think, well, you know, do they really mean that or what are they really planning? What they say is what they're going to do. So yes, you know, you're dealing with a straight deck there, for want of a better term. It would have been lovely if they hadn't realized. That would be such an advantage. We'd be lying our pants off.
I mean, the Sylvan immediately hangs up, which tells you the kind of alarm that they must feel having launched this invasion without this key piece of information. That, you know, because I would imagine, again, I want to avoid anthropomorphizing them, but I would imagine that the first thing that comes to their interconnected mind is, what if this is a trap? What if we've been fooled?
Yes. Yeah. Can we trust them? These people who we think are our followers, our supporters. Yes. They could be lying.
And all of that brings us to the incredibly violent culmination of the ETO, of Mike Evans's run as leader of and organizer of the ETO, and really the first strike back moment for Thomas Wade and Clarence Sheehan and his forces with the use of nanofibers to completely decimate the Judgment Day. Your thoughts on seeing it? It's a scene in the books, and I don't know what I pictured in my head when I was reading it for the first time, but it was just a jaw-dropping thing to watch on the screen.
Yes. And like you, I think I imagined it, and that was pretty horrendous. But to see it, and it was, you want to watch and see how it all pans out, but it was almost watching from behind the sofa. It's like, because you see people running and they try to get away or they stop and talk. And they don't stop, keep running. And they just get sliced. And there's no way getting around it. It was brutal. I did love the way they portrayed it. It seemed sort of scientifically, I keep on thinking, well, you know, you've got all these slices, how are they going to stack up? And initially, you don't even notice it's happening. And then you see the different layers sort of sloping onto the ground.
Oh my gosh. Well, this brings us to the end of Mr. Mike Evans, the end of the relationship between Mike and Dr. Ye, who has been arrested, and, you know, rightly so. I think that's quite fair. What do you think happens to the ETO now?
Say, well, after this devastation, because this is a wiping out of resources, most of their population, and also their relationship with the Santee is in jeopardy as well. So could they just sort of disappear? I think they're in a very vulnerable position now. I find it hard to see how they're going to survive this.
Well, we'll have to wait to see what happens next. But back to episodes 4 and 5, I caught up with the director of these episodes, Minkie Spiro, to chat about working with the cast, finding the humanity in all of the show's characters, and shooting that incredible Judgment Day sequence. One of the moments in your episodes that I think about a lot is when we learn that the Santee do not lie. They don't know how to do it. And I was wondering, when you read that scene on the Judgment Day, what was your reaction? It's hard to wrap my head around sometimes that you could go through life without even shaping the story that you want to tell in a way that you might want to present it.
Such an interesting concept, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like when you start to dissect Little Red Riding Hood, And when you suddenly see it for what it is a lie about a lie. And yet here we are feeding this to our children. And I'd never really thought about it before then. And so what kind of role models are we? I mean, it's fine when one completely dissects it like that, you could drive yourself mad. But one of the beautiful things about that is the innocence that suddenly becomes totally apparent to us about this other planet, this other race. And to hear Jonathan Pryce be challenged, do you lie? Well, maybe. I mean, not intentionally, but, and you suddenly realize that we all do it. And sometimes you think, you know, we call it a white lie because it's not really done with any animosity. But isn't it interesting how this planet, this alien world, don't know how to do it?
Yeah.
And there's something rather beautiful and inspiring that what if we could be a bit more truthful to ourselves, to other people? You know, they're not all bad.
Which forest? There are many forests on your world.
Oh, no. No, it's not real.
We do not understand.
Well, it's a story. You know, the wolf, the grandmother, the Little Red Riding Hood, none of them exist.
So the story, it is a lie about a liar?
Yeah. Yeah, I suppose it is.
We need to consider this.
It strikes me talking to you that you're an incredibly empathic individual. And when you're telling a story like this, and you have villains, I'm going to use air quotes, villains like the ETO, like Tatiana, like Evans, who are, you know, working quite actively to have an alien race conquer Earth, how do you get into their motivations so that the audience can understand why they're doing it?
So when I look at Evans, and I look at his upbringing, there are various significant moments in Evans's life that turned him. Now, I'm not saying he's not evil. I'm not saying his actions are commendable or acceptable. But I guess what I'm trying to say is that everyone has a story. And so when you are directing characters like Evans, you need to bear in mind, how can you make this complex person tangible to an audience that doesn't just see it as black and white evil and villain? So, for example, we talked about when he's talking to Sophon, this invisible being in his office. And I did this shot where I call it the insider shot, where I literally just pivot round him and let the focus just stay on him. He can't escape. And it's in those moments that you see these vulnerabilities, these questions, these fears, this gamut of emotions that he can't hide from the camera. The camera's too close. And it's in those moments I find the reveals in human nature so revealing. And so with somebody as phenomenal as Jonathan Pryce, you can give him that note of letting me in, of showing me warts and all, as well as also these moments where I see his evilness. And I hope that by doing so, we create an interesting villain. We create a villain that you want to learn more about.
And what about the brilliant Marlo Kelly's Tatiana?
Marlo's this genuinely like softy. She's this gorgeous, kind, funny, gentle soul. So it was so interesting working with her, you know, because it was interesting. Sometimes because she knew she was a villain, for want of a better word, she would sometimes slightly dial it up a bit and I'd be like, nah, let it go, throw it away. Like, it's more interesting that your loveliness comes through.
So yeah, we had a lot of fun playing with degrees of messed upness. With a character like Tatiana, who you know, maybe doesn't have the kind of expositional scenes that will give us entree into her biography, her history. How much do you and Marlo and the showrunners talk about the history of the character? What has brought the character to that place?
We speak a lot, because I think whether it's in exposition or not, I dissect the characters a lot with the actors prior to getting on the floor. So, well, first of all, I do like a tone meeting and a page turn with the showrunners. And in that, I also dissect character with them so that I'm informed, because writers obviously forget that they carry so much of this information with them as backstory when they're writing, and it doesn't always end up on the page, but they're aware of it. But I need to glean as much of that as possible so that I can make sure that those subtle nuances that have informed who Tatiana is, because she was brought up on the ship. She grew up, her family was that community that ultimately got obliterated. So if I know that and I can imagine, and then I start to think about the school lesson she had there, the kind of upbringing and the kind of daily life she inhabited, it makes it easier for me to design a scene with her that helps lean into that where necessary and shy away from it when it's not relevant. So it was really interesting, because you're right, a lot of Tatiana's backstory is not on the page. It's how and what she brings to it in her scenes.
The moment when we discover that Dr. Ye is the commander of the ETO at the ETO summit is a really a moment when a lot of the kind of like storylines in the show begin to intersect. What was it like to shoot that scene with so many extras? And, you know, it explodes into action. It seems like you must have been there a while.
Well, as the director, I'd say we weren't there long enough. I mean, we all want more time, don't we? No, but it's, you know, it's a very complicated sequence. But first, to just sort of think about that reveal of Ye Wenji is quite chilling.
Yeah.
She comes across as such an innocent, well-meaning grandmother to these Oxford graduates. And to be able to try and convey this utter betrayal that Jin feels, it was really interesting. And it's so easy to get sucked into the action of a sequence like that, and to spend all the, I think it was ultimately 3 days we had in that location, you know, doing all the stunts and the big set piece. Actually, it's those moments of truth that are so chilling that I just needed to protect in amongst all the fun and games and explosive sequences that we were filming, which, you know, obviously take time. As soon as you get stunts and pyrotechnics and crashing of walls, everything slows down because we need to do all of this very carefully. My approach to the ETO summit was very different to the Judgment Day demise. And I think that for me, when we are confronted with a disaster, there are really three ways we react. This is massive generalization, but there's flight, fight, and freeze. And I wanted to convey all of those.
Yeah.
Because it's, you know, not everyone gets up and attacks when they're being attacked. Some people run for their lives, other people freeze. And if we just had everyone running or everyone fighting, then we wouldn't really be conveying the gamut of what exists in these kind of war-type disasters. So yeah, I was constantly looking for emotion within these painful and graphic and surprising attacks.
When we cut from the boat to the control room where Augie, Wade, and Raj and the others are observing, you know, it underlines how the distance of a few meters can change reality completely. And it also just hammers home the raw violence of what we're seeing. What were you trying to convey in that cut between these two spaces?
I think it's so interesting when you watch something versus standing in it.
Yeah.
But I think the thing that really sells it is sound. And I think suddenly when you drop that sound, when you're in the operation room or central control room, and everything is an arm's length away, you've got that image in front of you, you're seeing it, you can't run away from it, but you go from the terror and the screams to the silence. I think sound is so undervalued as a storytelling device. And so in this sequence, I tried to push that as well as everything else that went with the visual storytelling.
What I think is really interesting about this show, and pointedly for episodes 4 and 5 that you directed, is it's really a lens into the moral questions that Liam Cunningham's Wade is dealing with in prosecuting this war. Do you have any particular thoughts about the morality of Wade's approach?
Liam is such a brilliant actor. And there is such a bravado that he portrays, which I don't believe he always has behind closed doors.
Right.
But he's quite funny. And I think humor is vital in a character like that, because otherwise it's quite difficult to stomach. But, you know, David and Dan and Alex were very good at juxtaposing him with somebody like Benny Wong, because then it makes it palatable. Because I think if you just had Wade on his own, it would be a struggle. But because he represents a faction of society, and, you know, on one level, you could say without that, who would really be kicking ass with this universe that was trying to invade these aliens? Like, you need somebody to have the chutzpah, to have the
right,
the gumption to say, screw you, we're going to give you as good as you give. And then you need somebody like Augie that reminds us of humanity and
yeah,
soul and the moral compass that we must all hold. Because ultimately, humanity can't exist without a strong moral compass. And Wade does not have this. And I would struggle to make a show that didn't at least give a side of humanity that exists and needs to be celebrated.
Do you think that their responses to this, you know, Wade is completely unflinching from this is his duty, this is what he's been charged with doing, and somebody's got to do it. Whereas Augie's completely shattered, as you expect one would be. And Raj, I think, interestingly, I think is, you know, quite ambitious and very interested in impressing Wade. Is there anything else that we can glean from their reactions to this? The mind kind of boggles at what it would be like to witness such a thing.
I think both Wade and Raj have the benefit of either having a profession in the military. So Raj is in the Navy. He's served in various wars. His father did too. He knew what they were doing. Augie was kept in the dark, because if they had told her, of course she would have said, F off. I mean, you're not using my technology for these purposes. So I think that for Augie, she was always going to be on the back foot. She was always going to be struggling. And then the consequences of what she enabled was going to be much more hard-hitting.
Well, episode 5 ends with the Santi revealing themselves quite dramatically to the people of Earth. And I would imagine wiping away any question about the morality of Wade's approach in a single blow. What was it like to film that scene? And what kind of chaos do you think would ensue from such a reveal?
Yeah, it was an amazing scene to direct, but There were challenges. No, I shouldn't say but, and there were challenges.
Yeah.
Because halfway through that scene, they put that mirror over. Now, how do you do that in Piccadilly Circus when you can't play God and tell the sun to go away at a certain point, right?
No.
And at the same time, there were restrictions at that location, so we couldn't bring in big frames with silks or blacks that we could then like push over them so that we could create our own shadow. Yeah, as you can imagine, there were a lot of moving pieces that needed constant consideration when designing this sequence.
It's fascinating. We could listen to you go on all day. Minkie, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Wow. Now that was a fascinating insight into the filming of the three-body problem. Thank you so much, Minkie. Now, in order to better understand the psychology behind the ETO, I spoke with writer and educator Dr. Alexandra Stein, an expert in cults and the psychology of ideological extremism. Dr. Stein has first-hand experience of being part of a cult and has since become a world-leading expert in how they form and operate. So before we get into the psychology behind the ETO, I asked her to share her story.
I was a young woman. I was 26 when I first encountered them. It was a political cult that was supposedly about social justice and equality. And they claimed to be connected to the civil rights movement, which I thought was a great thing. It all sounded like exactly the kinds of things I wanted to be doing. But I joined up, moved from California to the Midwest, to Minneapolis, St. Paul, and really got stuck or trapped in this group. I was married off rather quickly, which is one thing that cults do. They tend to control people's personal relationships. Well, they don't tend to, they do. All of them do. I was told what work to do. I was told really how to dress. I was told whether or not and when I should have children. I was told where to live. I was told who to be friends with, which was basically not to be friends with anyone.
So how did you manage to get out of the cult?
You know, I had doubts from the very beginning. But in a cult, you very quickly learn that you may not voice those doubts. That's a kind of one of the worst crimes. And so I kept the doubts in a sort of semi-conscious part of my brain, is what I would call it. But eventually a few things happened that validated my doubts. One was they tried to start controlling my children, in particular my then 5-year-old son. There was another thing where we met people who were actually working with the anti-apartheid movement who had come from South Africa, but they were jolly and fun and nice and warm and friendly, none of which was really considered values in our cult. We had to always be serious and on task and not much laughter. Most cults are not known for their sense of humor.
Right.
And then the final thing that was really important was someone in the cult, a woman, just slowly started confiding in me very tentatively until we got to a point of trusting each other where we did share our doubts. And that was huge.
So you can voice them.
Exactly.
Yes.
And finally I went, oh my God, with this woman. I didn't know it was a cult at that point, but we talked about power problems and we decided we were going to get out.
So with the three-body problem, we sort of give an insight into the workings of what, well, I'd like to see if you think it's a cult, because the sort of Earth Trisolaris Organization, otherwise known as the ETO. So you've seen the programs. What did you think of the ETO? What struck you about them? And would you define them as a cult?
Well, you know, I like to be careful because not everything's a cult. And I wanted to know more about the leader in a way. I saw what we would call charisma, the nice part that charms people and seems very sweet and caring. What I didn't see so much was the other element that you need in a cult leader, which is authoritarianism or bullying, a bullying personality.
Yes, sort of mercenary.
Well, yes, mean, controlling, cruel, ruthless. without empathy. Yeah, Mercenary covers a lot of those, yeah. So they kind of flip between those two, the charm and the ruthless, depending what is going to work at that moment.
Yes. And so do you see, because if we look at the hallmarks of a cult, is that one of the hallmarks of a leader? You need to be this sort of bisable, you know, dole out what's needed at a time to keep the cult together.
Well, that's the first one, because a cult doesn't really operate without someone who starts it and keeps it running. You know, these are people who don't come from happy backgrounds. And the way they feel safe is to have this total control over other people. And then once they have that, they can do anything they want with them. The second hallmark is you isolate people and you have this rigid hierarchical structure with the leader, you know, at the top and everyone else having to obey and follow. And they're isolated from the outside world. They're isolated from each other. That thing I was talking about you can't share doubts with each other. They're very odd relationships in a cult. They're kind of weirdly close, but not really trusting. The third thing is the belief system, which is shown a lot in the program, that there's, you know, these aliens and you're communicating with whoever this lord is. You have a whole complex belief system that the leader is the one who knows what it is. Mike Evans, he's the only one who can speak to the leader, as far as I could see.
Yes, he speaks to the lord. And yes, so it's the one direct access, and then he disseminates the information to the others, but he is the point of contact.
Exactly. So he's got the magical word from above, so as to speak. So you pretty much always have a version of that. And it's also a belief system that answers all your questions forever about everything. You don't need any other belief system to intrude.
I see. It covers everything you ever need to know. Gosh.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's an important bit, because that helps isolate people. So that's the third. The fourth thing is the process of brainwashing, as I call it. And that goes back to the leader's personality of this kind of good cop, bad cop dynamic. You know, I'm great. I'm wonderful and nice. The group is wonderful and nice. But at the same time, we're going to tell you there's a lot of things to be frightened of. And some of those things are what's going to happen to you in the future, what's going to happen to you if should you dare to leave, what's going to happen if you criticize what's happening, the end of the world is coming, all kind of different ways to make you feel fearful. But we're the nice, good people, so you get this contradiction. So it keeps you off kilter.
Yeah, unstable.
Unstable, and with nowhere else to turn because you're isolated. So you end up kind of sticking to the group because, well, they are nice.
I'd like to talk about recruitment, because at this stage of the story, we know that the ETO have been using this virtual reality game as what Wade quotes as a recruitment tactic. And in the real world, what are some of the methods that people in cults use to recruit people?
Well, of course, nowadays, you know, we do so much of our communication online. So even though we have this kind of way of saying there's in real life versus online, but online is real life. So, of course, there's a lot of online groups, you know, where you might have study groups online. If you look at something like QAnon, which I pretty much think is a cult, you know, that was pretty much online. But whether it's online or not online, it starts usually gently, if that's the word I'm looking for, you know, with something that's going to appeal. Like, you know, go to your gym and learn how to get stronger, do your weight training. So there may be some cults that recruit through martial arts or fitness centers. I mean, I think in England, some of the extreme Islamist groups recruited through martial arts centers. Or for women, we've got yoga. There's many a cult that recruits through yoga studios.
Gosh, I find that surprising, because yoga seems so peaceful and calming, but I guess it's just the right hook.
It's the right hook. You go there because who doesn't like yoga, you know? And pretty soon they bring out the image of the leader. And pretty soon you're meditating to that image, because, of course, in yoga, you often meditate at the beginning and the end. And then pretty soon you're volunteering to help run other classes. And then gradually, like the frog in the warm water, you know,
yes,
you start getting so that you become what I call engulfed in this group. You drop your other activities because, well, you're not going to really develop if you don't spend every evening here. And you often get these kind of levels, like Scientology does this, where you start with level one, and of course they recruit through personality tests. Are you depressed today? So there's always a come on that is going to appeal to a certain person. Like, I wouldn't have been appealed to by a religious cult because I don't have that. That's not part of my life culture. But a political cult, yeah. So, you know, I always like to say there's a cult there for everyone.
yes.
Unless you've learned how cults operate, and then that's very protective because then you can spot it.
Yes. So going on to sort of the judgment day, early in episode 4, Wade and Daishi discover the ETO's headquarters is this ship called Judgment Day. And we see sort of a games pitch, seating areas, canteen. It is really a community. Now, looking at the ETO and also real life cults, it's interesting to build this sort of central community on a ship. What do you think are the benefits of that?
Well, physical isolation is very helpful for isolating people, even though not all cults do it. But, you know, if you look at Jonestown, the famous cult led by Jim Jones, where over 900 people met their ends, or if you look at Waco with David Koresh, which was also a terrible tragedy where many people died, they were both physically isolated. So you can clearly control people better if they can't get off a ship.
And I suppose when you've got them isolated, you can feed whatever you want to them and there's no counteracting it.
Exactly. There's no way to get other information or support or help from anybody else. Everyone's trying to behave the same way to stay out of trouble. So you look at everyone else, they're all obeying, so you go ahead and obey. You're not allowed to talk about your doubts, so your emotions are kind of completely collapsed in a way. You just are putting one foot in front of the other, trying to get through the day without getting in trouble.
After Jack's death, June agrees to go undercover to the ETO London Summit. And this is an exclusive meeting for sort of members and new recruits. And so what did you think of the summit? Did it sort of hang true to what you know about cults?
I think the whole security thing, and that she says, where are we going? And they don't answer. You know, it builds this kind of allure. You know, this is special. Not everyone can have this. You know, it's a one-time offer, right? We've got inside knowledge that other people don't have. And they're just the poor little peons down there. And we're the clever ones who have special access.
And we've invited you, so your ego is, oh my goodness, I'm part of the elite.
Yeah, and that's really important. That's an important part of the cult thing.
And now they are coming to share their knowledge with us, to teach us how to survive and to thrive. They travel to us at enormous speeds, but it will take them centuries to arrive. 400 years.
400 years.
Space is big.
History falls to us and to our children and to their children after them. We must prepare the world for their arrival and prepare our descendants to welcome them.
And then also we see, you know, I think groups like Scientology, and people can see this on YouTube and things, you know, I think they like to have these glitzy events. You know, that creates excitement and, wow, we're doing something great. You know, you just kind of get swept along in it. You know, it's like going to a rock concert or something. When a big group of people gets together.
The mob mentality, yes.
Yeah, that crowd, the energy of the crowd is a real thing. It feels good.
While Jin is at the summit, Tatiana mentions Jin's childhood. And to quote her, she says, "You haven't had anyone protecting you since the flood took your parents away. Now you do. This has been my family since I was a little girl." Looking again at the vulnerable, and I guess there are
a series of vulnerabilities that potential recruiters for cults will look out for.
So there's a couple interesting points in what you've just asked. First of all, you are more vulnerable if you're at a transition point in life. Like if you leave home to go to university, right? Not with your mum and dad and your old friends. Or if you break up with someone, or if you've had a bereavement, or even if you go to a new job. So you're naturally looking for some new affiliations or relationships or things to do, clubs to join, to meet people. So most people will just go ahead and do that. But unlucky people will run into a cult at that point, like me, join the wrong political group. That's what we call a situational vulnerability, which are things that happen to all of us. The other thing you mentioned was that family thing, we're your family. Now, nearly all cults use that kind of language. You know, the leader is your father. In George Orwell's 1984, there's Big Brother. The leader of Cambodia's terrible totalitarian cult, the Khmer Rouge, was brother number one. I mean, I know a lot of non-cult religious organizations use this language as well. So, you know, I'm not saying that anyone who uses that language is a cult, but cults often definitely do. And they say, you know, we are your family now. That is very typical cult language. And they'll be using that language at the very same moment they're cutting you off from your actual family.
So now, Jack was killed by Tatiana because he'd already been told too much about the ETO and he refused to join them. Now, when Tatiana kills Jack, she shows no remorse at all. This is necessary. And when Mike Evans hears that Jack didn't make it, there just seems to be no remorse at all. Can the ideas of protection take over and sort of tip people over into extremism?
Yes, totally. But also, it's not just the idea. So the leader has no remorse, right? So that is part of their psychological makeup. They can go around killing people or telling other people to kill on their behalf without any problem. The follower often isn't that kind of person, but they are so trapped within the system that it's like they don't have any other choice. You're not really thinking almost about what you're doing. You're just doing to save yourself in a way. And it's not conscious. You're just, you don't know what else to do. You're in a kind of state of terror. You can't name and you can't show it. So it appears to the outside world like you're totally in control going ahead and doing this. But in fact, you're not. You're instinctively trying to get through whatever this is.
Yes. So it feels as if the will of the leader becomes your will.
Yeah.
And you have no question in that. And so you can do anything because the leader wants it.
Yes, because that's how you keep yourself safe.
Yes, yes.
You don't have any other way. It's a phenomena that in the field that I work in, we call fright without solution. You have nothing useful you can do to make it better. So you just do what the leader tells you. It's a hard thing to explain.
Yes. And also, I think it's hard to explain because unless you're isolated, unless you're in that situation and set up with that sort of mentality, because I think people often think, well, why don't you just get away? But I think when you're so immersed in it, you can't see a way of getting away.
You can't get away. Yeah. And also, look, Jack tried to get away. What happened to him? So you're seeing that and you're going, whoops, I better not do that. They're going to come after me.
Yes, yes. Because in terms of sort of controlling information, it's quite interesting because with the ETO, Mike Evans is sort of telling the story of Little Red Riding Hood and the Santee goes silent. But Mike maintains the illusion of continuing to speak to the Santee, even though they've cut him off. And so this illusion and this sort of setting up, you know, this conduit and smoke and mirrors seems to be quite a bit at play as well.
Well, thank you for bringing that up because deception is key with cults. They're all operating a kind of fiction. I mean, it's hard to talk about in terms of ETO because we're talking about science fiction.
Yes.
But in real life, that isn't science fiction. They're all making up the story, including the leader often makes up their own history. Nearly all the leaders have this thing of like, you know, I was this poor, downtrodden drug addict or something. And then one day I woke up and I saw the answer coming down from the sky. And now I've got the magic answer that I want to share with everyone. They all have that kind of story.
Yes, that story arc, yes.
And they're going to share it with you if you just behave yourself and do what they tell you and become as wonderful and great as they are. So they all have this fiction, and that by its nature is deceptive. And also the recruitment is deceptive because what you see at the beginning is not what you're going to get. You're not told when you start with Scientology taking the personality test that the secret story is that there are aliens that came out of a volcano and are now inhabiting your body, you know, which is their belief system. Now, if you got that at the beginning, you would go, I don't think so. You have to get brought to that point through all these processes of isolation and secrecy and so on and so forth. But yes, deception and fiction is key.
At the end of episode 5, the ETO members at the London summit have either been killed or arrested. Their headquarters on Judgment Day have been destroyed, and all those on board killed, including Mike Evans, and only Tatiana remains free. Now, if this was a real-life cult, do you see any parallels of anything that's going on here? And do you think this will be the last of the ETO, or do you think it can survive this?
If the only one left is Tatiana, she's going to have a lot of hard work to do. You know, she's got to start recruiting, doesn't she? Like I said, it's not necessarily easy to start a cult. You've got to put a lot of energy into it. But on the other hand, she will understand how to. She will know the dynamics. So she's probably got to look out for her first recruit and build up from there. But I would say it'd be quite challenging. But not impossible.
Well, it was a really interesting conversation with Dr. Alexandra Stein. And it's fascinating to find out how the ETO relates to cults in real life. Thanks very much to Dr. Stein and also Director Minkie Spiro.
That's it for this episode of the Three Body Podcast. But make sure you join us next time, where we'll be digging into episodes 6 and 7.
Humanity is in crisis at the news that the Santi will be arriving in 400 years. So we'll be chatting with director Jeremy Podeswa about crafting these episodes and expressing humanity's existential dread. We'll also talk about Will's story in particular and how it affects the rest of the Oxford Five.
We'll also be talking to associate psychology professor at Arizona State University, Michael Varnum. He's part of the university's Interplanetary Initiative, which seeks to investigate humanity's possible futures in space. He'll be providing real-world insight into how humanity might react to the discovery of alien life.
See you next time.
Bye.